Do any other members wish to be heard? Chair recognizes Ms. Mace from South Carolina.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Chairman Comer. First of all, my first question is, who bribed Hunter Biden to be here today? That's my first question. Second question, you are the epitome of white privilege, coming into the Oversight Committee, spitting in our face, ignoring a congressional subpoena to be deposed. What are you afraid of? You have no balls to come up here and...
Mr. Chairman, point of inquiry.
Mr. Chairman...
if the gentlelady wants to hear from Hunter Biden, we can hear from him right now, Mr. Chairman. Let's take a vote and hear from Hunter Biden. What are you afraid of?
Hold on. Order.
Are women allowed to speak in here or no? Are women allowed to speak in here or no? Because you keep interrupting me.
I'll interrupt the chairman. I don't know that he's a lady.
I think that that Hunter Biden should be arrested right here, right now, and go straight to jail. Our nation is founded on the rule of law. And the premise the law applies equally to everyone, no matter what your last
point of order, Mr. Chairman. Point of order.
It doesn't matter who you are.
Point of order, Mr. Chairman. Biggs over here.
Donald Trump Jr.
Biggs over here.
State your point, Mr. Biggs.
Yeah, my point of order is this. Are we going to continue on with this blatant interruption? This is absurd and inappropriate. I intend to give my statement. I don't intend to have anybody interrupt it. I'm not going to interrupt your statements. I think you should have decorum and courtesy and don't act like a bunch of nimrods.
You just interrupted a woman.
And that's five.
I got permission.
Can we agree?
Mr. Chairman,
minutes. Can we agree?
Point of order again. The assertion that I interrupted was absolutely false. That's typical of the gentleman who spoke it. I got permission to speak from the chairman. I spoke. I was interrupted yet again by the gentleman who doesn't choose to go through the chair and follow proper order. I encourage us, I think if we're going to have any respect at all, we need to have proper decorum.
Well said.
I'd like to finish.
The rules are everyone's going to be recognized for 5 minutes. Anyone that wants to be recognized will be recognized for 5 minutes. Ms. Mace has 4 minutes. And 13 seconds left. Chair recognizes Ms. Mace.
It does not matter who you are, where you come from, or who your father is, or your last name. Yes, I'm looking at you, Hunter Biden, as I'm speaking to you. You are not above the law at all. The facts in this case are crystal clear. This committee used and issued a lawful subpoena to Hunter Biden, a critical witness in this committee's investigation into Biden family corruption. Hunter Biden and his lawyers did not claim privilege of any kind because clearly he has none. They didn't contest the legitimacy of our reasons for issuing this subpoena, no reasons, because they clearly are legitimate. And yet, he refused to comply. Trump's family members, Don Trump Jr., he did not defy a congressional subpoena. He showed up multiple times for multiple depositions for several hours. In doing so, you know, Hunter Biden broke the law. He did so deliberately. You did so flagrantly. You showed up on the Hill, on the Senate side, the day of that congressional subpoena to defy it and spit in the face of this committee. That's what you did. The question the American people are asking us is, what is Hunter Biden so afraid of? Why can't you show up for a congressional deposition? You're here for a political stunt. This is just a PR stunt to you. This is just a game that you are playing with the American people. You're playing with the truth. Hunter Biden wasn't afraid to sell access to Joe Biden to the highest bidder when he was in elected office. He wasn't afraid to trade on the Biden brand, peddle influence, and share those ill-gotten gains with members of his family, including Joe Biden. He wasn't afraid to compromise the integrity of the presidency and vice presidency by involving Joe Biden in shady business deals with our foreign adversaries. But Hunter Biden, you were too afraid to show up for a deposition. And you still can't today. I believe that Hunter Biden should be held completely in contempt. I think he should be hauled off to jail right now because it wasn't long ago, too, my friends on the other side of the aisle, that you also believed in the power of a congressional subpoena. Not long ago at all. You believed in holding those who refused to comply with a congressional subpoena accountable. And I stood with each and every one of you. I am the only member in this room today who has held a member of my own party in contempt of Congress for not showing up for a subpoena. And I see nothing but complete hypocrisy on the other side of the aisle. The ranking member of this committee even so eloquently put it, the lesson is, please tell your children out there in America, if you get a subpoena to go before Congress, go. you have a legal responsibility to do so. So the hypocrisy is stunning. What are we to tell our children today? There's nothing the other side can say with a straight face. As the only member of this committee to vote to hold a member of contempt of my own party, let me be clear, this should not be a partisan issue. If Congress issues a subpoena, you show up, period. This is not a responsibility we take lightly. It brings no joy for us to do this, but the president's son broke the law and must be held accountable in the same way anybody else would. I urge my colleagues on both sides of the aisle to do so. And my last message to you, Hunter Biden, you play stupid games, you win stupid prizes.
Will the gentlelady yield for a question?
I recognize Ms. Green from Georgia for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Excuse me, Hunter. Apparently you're afraid of my words.
Whoa!
Oh! I'd like to reclaim my time, Mr. Chairman.
Burst their bubble. Wow, that's too bad.
I think it's clear and obvious for everyone watching this hearing today that Hunter Biden is terrified of strong conservative Republican women because he can't even face my words as I was about to speak to him. What a coward. And this is also a coward that sat right here in front of Mickey Babbitt, Ashley Babbitt's mother, who was murdered on January 6th by Michael Byrd, the Capitol Police officer, and the you want to talk about a committee, a political sham? I'll totally disagree with you, Ms. Mace. That January 6th committee was not bipartisan. It was a complete setup to go after President Trump, go after Republicans, go after anyone that believes in free and fair elections, people that believe the Department of Justice should be fair and balanced, not a political weaponized department of the federal government that is targeting President Trump, his supporters, people that walked in the Capitol on January 6th, and now people that stood outside the Capitol. There's been no justice for Ashley Babbitt's family. Michael Byrd has never been charged with anything. He was let off, and he was given a promotion and allowed to walk free. And Hunter Biden just walked out. That is an example of not following the law. Hunter Biden thinks he's above the law. Don Jr., Eric Trump, Ivanka, Trump family members had to come in to Democrat subpoenas and be questioned by Democrats for over 8 hours, each of them. Hunter Biden runs away. Hunter Biden did not come when we subpoenaed him. He did not follow the law. And then one of our colleagues helped him evade his subpoena by going and reserving a press conference for him on his behalf, helped him evade the subpoena, helped Hunter Biden break the law. Let's talk about his own father's words. President Joe Biden said in October 2021 that individuals who defy subpoenas from the January 6th House Select Committee should be prosecuted. And the Justice Department indicted Steve Bannon for doing so in November 2021. Hunter Biden's father, the President of the United States, said that he should be prosecuted. Anyone that defies a subpoena should be prosecuted. Hunter Biden didn't show up for his subpoena. Hunter Biden showed up today to make a clown show of himself, to show that he is nothing but someone that will not obey the law, that wants to show up when he wants to, and sits here with a smug look on his face and runs away when it's my turn to talk. Not only is he a criminal, but he is a coward. Nothing but a coward. Let's talk about voting for things. We have members on this committee that are on record on their own Twitter accounts talking about people blowing off subpoenas on the January 6th committee that states the rule of law is stirring all over America. That's Representative Jamie Raskin right here. I'll enter this for the record. Representative Jamie Raskin. Steve Bannon has been convicted of acting in contempt of Congress. My argument with Rep. Gates is now settled. If subpoenaed, you show up and assert any privilege you think applies to specific questions, but you can't blow off the proceeding. He blew it off. Walking in today is too late. We have to hold Hunter Biden in contempt of Congress because he's not above the law, and neither is the President of the United States. And this committee has produced more evidence that any Democrat ever dreamed of having against President Trump and his family, while they constantly make up lies and attacks about the Trump family and President Trump. They make them up all day long. It's nothing but a political witch hunt. This committee has produced the evidence that Joe Biden has taken payments through his son, Hunter Biden, and all their dozens of fake LLCs. You can't buy a Biden product. You can't hire a Biden for a service unless you're a foreign country and you're asking and paying for political favors and political payouts. And that is exactly what the Biden brand is all about. We will hold Hunter Biden in contempt. And if the Democrats are not the hypocrites that they constantly display that they are, then they will vote for contempt of Congress because they voted for it on every other subpoena that didn't go through. And here's the last thing. You guys had your chance. If you wanted to hold people in contempt of Congress, you could have done it last Congress, but you didn't do it, and it would have been a major mistake because you know that it could have been turned exactly back on you. Mr. Chairman, I yield.
Perry for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'd just like to remind members of this committee, anybody watching, that this is a duly constituted committee under the rules of the House of Representatives. Duly constituted. You see Republicans on this side and Democrats on that side. The Democrats on that side were selected by their leadership and their process. Same thing for the Republicans on this side. Why do I mention that? Why do I bring that up? Because this is a stark difference from what is being referenced on the other side of the aisle. The so-called J6 committee, which was nothing more than a Soviet show trial in America. That's what that was. And so every single action that they took, subpoenaing people, disparaging people, referring charges of people, were not legitimate. Were not legitimate. So to compare what's happening today to what happened years ago is completely out of context, and you need to understand that. This is a game for these folks. Sure, they want to support their guy. They don't care about America. They don't care about what the president's doing to destroy America. They're just locking arms to support their guy. And God bless them, they can do that. If you want to vote for people that do that, that's your right. Now, in my opinion, this committee is not interested in prosecuting Hunter Biden. We're not interested in that. Hunter Biden is a sad tale by his own right, by his own admission, by leaving his evidence all around for everybody to see. The other side complains that documents and photographs are shown in this committee about Hunter Biden. Don't blame the person that showed the documents or the photographs. The person that committed the acts is the person who is responsible for the acts. And we do take no joy because it's a waste of time to prosecute Hunter Biden. But he created this for himself along with the rest of his sad tale of his life, unfortunate that it may be. But we, in this committee, on both sides of the aisle, on behalf of the American people, are charged with finding the facts. And the facts show that President Biden profited from his name. And the person that arranged the deals was Hunter Biden. And so we would like to delve into that. Now, Hunter Biden, regardless of his last name, even though he thinks he's special, he thinks he can leave evidence all around and blame it on the Russians when he knows it was him. He can go on TV and say that he thinks he's special because his last name's Biden and that no one will touch him. Ladies and gentlemen, the great thing about America is that we're all special. Because the law is blind to each one of us, regardless of our station, our economic position, or our political position. Hunter Biden sadly chose to violate federal law. That's unfortunate. But we are duty-bound to do something about it, because without law, we have anarchy. And that's what Hunter Biden would like. By coming here today, he shows that he can be here. He shows that he displays that he could show up to a lawfully, legitimately presented subpoena, but he chooses not to, and that's his choice. He can do that. But there are consequences for that, ladies and gentlemen. There are consequences for that. And we are duty bound.
Will the gentleman yield down here, Mr. Perry?
I will not yield. We are duty bound. We are duty bound to pursue the consequences of that so that the American people can trust in the system of justice in the United States of America, which they do not right now. They don't trust in it, nor should they, because this side of the aisle has made a mockery of it for the last 3 years and beyond that.
Will the gentleman yield for?
I will not yield. Mr. Biden is not special. He was given a subpoena. He should have appeared. He chose not to. We have no choice. We have no choice if we are to uphold our oath, to uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States. We have no choice except to refer charges and find Hunter Biden in contempt. His choice. That was his choice. Now we have to make our choice. And conflating the so-called J6 committee, unduly authorized, not a committee, no jurisdiction, no authority whatsoever under the law of anything. To conflate that with these proceedings today is an abomination. My friends on the other side of the aisle know what they're doing, should be ashamed, should be embarrassed, but will not be. Regardless, we must forge on for the sake of this republic. I yield the balance.
Gentlemen's time's
expired.
Mr. Biggs for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At the risk of taking the bait, which is all this is, it's laying a little bait, and it might be just too attractive for me, so I got to get in on it, just a little bit. I'm intrigued by the assertions of my colleagues who claim that the Hunter Biden violation of the subpoena scenario is the same as issuing subpoenas to four members of Congress. I'm intrigued by that. I really am. It's interesting. Had the illegitimate J6 group decided to pursue to enforce its dubious subpoena against me, my counsel was prepared to argue that service of that subpoena was insufficient. And so asserted to counsel for the J6 committee. Had the illegitimate J6 gaggle sought to enforce its subpoenas, my counsel, and I believe the counsel of each member of Congress who had been subpoenaed, ostensibly subpoenaed, putatively subpoenaed, would also have asserted successfully a privilege under the Constitution of the United States. Those questions never arose formally because the now defunct J6 committee, which has no authority anymore because it passed with the closing of the last session of Congress. I think that cabal surely understood that its tenuous claims, how tenuous its claims were, and chose not to try and enforce its questionable subpoenas. And now, why do I say that? I say it because in reporting to Reuters, the committee's own chairman, Benny Thompson, said this, quote, "There are some questions of whether we have the authority to compel testimony from Republican colleagues." He knew. He knew you didn't have that authority, but yet you still tried to assert it. Now, what's the distinction? Well, Hunter Biden has no claim to insufficiency of service of process. Why do we know? Because he stood on the lawn of the Senate the same day that he was supposed to be here and asserted publicly, hey, I'm supposed to be somewhere else. I'm supposed to be giving a deposition, but I won't do it. I won't do it. Secondly, Hunter Biden has claimed no privilege against testifying before this committee or the Judiciary Committee pursuant to the subpoena, except for the privilege that he has claimed throughout his life. And as the LA Times said about Hunter Biden, quote, "Biden is still on the nepotism gravy train," close quote. As the Daily Mail reported, quote, "Hunter admits he got $50,000 a month job on the board of Ukrainian gas company Burisma because of his family name," close quote. And it goes on and on. Again, the LA Times describes Hunter Biden as a, quote, "child of privilege," close quote. That's the only privilege Hunter Biden has ever asserted. He asserts that not that he should be exempt from testifying because there is some constitutional proscription, that even the chairman of this committee would agree to, as as Benny Thompson agreed to on the J6 committee's issuance of subpoenas to members of Congress. No, he doesn't assert that kind of privilege. He asserts only the privilege that he does not need to come and testify before the United States Congress, who's issued him subpoena. His attorneys acknowledge that subpoena, and he personally has acknowledged that subpoena for the simple reason that he is a Biden. So, where are we? Merrick Garland has authorized pursuing Republicans for contempt of Congress. He must also authorize prosecution of Hunter Biden. Failure to do so on the part of the Attorney General will show his contempt for Congress as well. But it will show even greater contempt for the American people who now recognize the weaponization of the federal government and the two-tier system promulgated by Democrats. Mr. Chairman, to Mr. Thompson's, to former Chairman Thompson's questioning of his own authority to actually issue subpoenas to members of Congress, Chairman Jordan requested legal analysis and authorities, but Chairman Thompson never responded. That committee could have pursued contempt if they thought there was valid subpoenas issued and a contemptible, a warranted contempt citation. They chose not to. Their authority expired, and ours is not expired. We should issue contempt. I yield back.
Gentleman yields back.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is an incredible first hearing with the committee.
Welcome to the Oversight Committee.
This was entirely predictable, I think, what we were going to hear and see today. We saw that Hunter came and staged a PR stunt with my friend from Florida, Mr. Moskowitz. That was clearly organized and recognized. But what I'm hearing from the ranking member and his colleagues that claim that transcripts are subject to, quote, partisan and twisted leaks and distortions is incredibly rich. Let's talk about calling the kettle black first. The country suffered through an entire impeachment proceeding of a president of the United States because of a false dossier in a SCIF, a compartmented facility, where every hearing and every transcript started with, this is an unclassified proceeding, then to have it selectively leaked and lied to the American people, to the great damage to this nation, but then bring it to this committee, because I'm new, I watched yesterday as committee Democrats continued to spin false narratives, several of which went out just yesterday as interviews were ongoing with Hunter Biden's art dealer, which is rich in and of itself, that Congressman Golden on the other side of the aisle went to the press during the interviews and spun a narrative while it was going on, but he conveniently admitted that 70% of the art buyers were Biden donors. So we can go down the line and talk
about
spin. That's
false, sir. That's not the fact.
But the other thing that we're hearing today, well, member so-and-so, congressman so-and-so, Congressman Jordan, they didn't comply with their subpoenas. But let's have a quick lesson on the Constitution. Article 1, Section 6 of the Constitution, the speak and debate clause, essentially protects all of us from abiding by each other's subpoenas. Otherwise, this body would do nothing but subpoena each other. So I would encourage my colleagues to look up Article 1, Section 6, and look at the case law of the speech and debate clause and why my colleagues rightfully did not abide by that subpoena. But let's talk about precedent for a moment of a president's son abiding by lawful subpoenas of the Congress. Donald Trump Jr. came before this body. He came before the House Intelligence Committee, he came before the House Judiciary Committee, he came before the Senate Intelligence Committee twice, he came before the so-called Jan 6 Committee, all behind closed doors where lawyers can sit down both sides of the aisle and have a conversation, go through documents all under oath, which is the precedent for any committee. Don Jr. came before committees and came before this body five times behind closed doors. What is Hunter Biden afraid of? What won't he do? And Ranking Member Raskin, you're going to reap what you sow, my friend. I mean, you insisted on depositions for those who appeared before the Jan 6 committee when Steve Bannon agreed to testify publicly. You argued, sir, that he should have to sit for a closed-door interview, just like every other witness. Quote, the way we have treated every single witness is the same. They come in behind closed doors. They talk to the committee there. You said on an interview in front of CBS in 2022, but now that Republicans are doing the same process, following House rules, doing the investigating, somehow Hunter Biden, because he's a Biden, should be held to a different standard. At the end of the day, we had a government official in the President of the United States, a vice president, set up 30 shell companies. Why? What product did those companies sell? Nothing. Vice President Biden was charged with two countries in his portfolio, China and Ukraine, while the vice president, his son, traveled on official business on Air Force Two and received massive monetary contributions afterwards. We have laws in place, colleagues, that prevent foreign powers from influencing government officials. Were policies changed as a result of the dinners, the calls, the text messages that we know President Biden engaged in through his son? We have a duty to get to the bottom of it. We will reference this contempt, and we will see if the Attorney General will uphold a fair standard of the law.
The time's up, Mr. Chairman.
Yep. And prosecute Hunter Biden.
Time's
Thank you,
expired.
Mr. Chairman.
Chair now recognizes Ms. Crockett for 5 minutes. Now chair recognizes Mr. Burchett from Tennessee
Chairman.
For 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My colleagues even want to talk about the justice system, so let's talk about it. November of last year, the chairman issued a subpoena to Hunter Biden to appear on December 13th, for a closed-door deposition. Instead of respecting the rule of law, Hunter Biden chose to give a press conference on the front steps of the Senate. To show such contempt for Congress without fear of repercussions highlights a theme throughout this administration and Democrat administrations before it. If you're a big-name Democrat, then you're immune to prosecution. Former Attorney General Eric Holder said as much in a memo he wrote regarding collateral consequences. For those who don't know, the collateral consequence policy allowed prosecutors to consider whether charging a company or individual will result in greater societal harm than not charging them. It's why the banks weren't held criminally accountable to the fallout of the 2008 financial crisis. It is why Jeffrey Epstein's clients aren't behind bars. It's also the mindset of President Biden and his family. Too big to jail. Not too big to fail, too big to jail. The two-tier justice system is a disgrace to our country and the principles it was founded on. I thank the chairman and the committee for the hard work they put in to hold the Biden administration accountable, but I doubt our Justice Department has the guts or the wherewithal to do anything about it. And I would like to yield my time to my friend from Florida, Byron Donalds. Let me yield to Ms. May. She hasn't gotten enough quality TV time today, so I'll give her a little more time.
Thank you, and then I'll yield to my colleague from Florida. I'm going to try to be quick here because I was accused by my colleague on the other side of the aisle about my white privilege. I want to say, number one, as the former ranking member of the Civil Rights Subcommittee under Chairman Raskin last session, I take great pride as a white female Republican to address the inadequacies in our country. I come from a district where rich and poor is literally black and white, black versus white on most days. My largest jail in my district, which is the largest jail in the state of South Carolina, has had 7 or 8 deaths in the last 2 years. And I was there with our black and African American council members trying to get the right thing done. And I come from a district where black men have been killed by law enforcement, tased to death in our jails. And I've stood with those black families because I know the differences that they see day to day in their life, and I try to do the best that I can. I come from a district where the first African-American, first black man in the U.S. House of Representatives was Joseph P. Rainey, represented my district back in the 1800s with that. The last black member of the U.S. House of Representatives before Reconstruction came from South Carolina, George P. Murray, the black man, former slave, an entrepreneur who founded the Republican Party in South Carolina. One of the founding members was named Robert Smalls, who commandeered a Confederate ship and gave it to Union soldiers and served his country admirably in the process. In my district, it was Harriet Tubman, and you can see it in the movie Harriet, who rescued more than 700 slaves in one night in Beaufort County, South Carolina. So I am very well aware of our rich history and try to recognize it as best as I can in the position that I have, and I resent the fact that you're going to throw that in my face up here. I'm one of the few people that you'll see on my side of the aisle trying to do the right thing to the right people every single day. And I would like to yield the remaining balance of time to my colleague from Florida.
This has been a very interesting hearing. Mr. Waltz, welcome to Oversight. Yes, it usually gets like this. Look, let's be very clear. This isn't about Hunter Biden's white privilege. It's about Hunter Biden's Democrat privilege. Because Donald Trump Jr. showed up for 5 congressional subpoenas. There was never this circus where he was subpoenaed by House Democrats and he showed up on the Senate side or showed up at the White House to answer in some fake, phony, lame press conference, not actually going to the House and doing what he was compelled by a subpoena to do. Hunter Biden did that. And then he has the unmitigated gall to show up here when we know that we're going through actually the legislation for contempt, with, by the way, Mr. Chairman, we should actually get to the legislation of contempt. The speechifying is great, but let's do our business, members. He has the gall to come here, show up, and then when the Democrats are saying, hey, he wants to speak, he leaves. This is a joke. This is a farce. The man has been subpoenaed by Congress. Oh, and by the way, the January 6th committee, Mr. Raskin, which you did sit on, by the way, that was not a normally ordered committee of Congress because Nancy Pelosi did not want the Republican members that then Leader McCarthy put up.
According to the courts, it was.
I my time, sir.
Will you yield for a correction?
I was respectful of your time. I didn't say anything. So, ladies and gentlemen, let's move forward with our business. He should be held in contempt. There was a subpoena. He did not answer it. Any other American will be held in contempt by Congress. Any other. This is Democrat privilege of the highest order. Let's do our jobs. I yield.
Recognizes Ms. McClain for 5 minutes.
So I just want to bring everything back home. This hearing is a contempt of Congress hearing for Hunter Biden. It's not about January 6th. It's not about Mr. Perry. It's not about white privilege. It's a contempt of Congress hearing about Hunter Biden. Although I appreciate the diversion tactics, like my colleague from Florida said, let's get back to our business, which is actually the contempt of Congress. I also want to thank my colleague, Ms. Cortez. I agree. Let him comply, right? Let him comply. And with our ranking member, let's follow the rule of law. So in contrast, let me read the rules of the committee. Real quickly, it's on page 9 of the rule book, right? And it talks about notices. Notices for the taking of depositions shall specify the date, the time, and the place of examination. Depositions may continue from day to day. Then you go to section D, consultation with the ranking minority member of the committee shall include, listen for it, 3 calendar days notice. So although I'm sure any defendant would like to come in and say, Judge, I want to come in on this day, and the defendant is going to tell the judge and the legal system how the trial is going to run, unfortunately, that's not how it works. It's really simple. So I do agree with you. Let him comply. Let him comply with the subpoena that we gave him. He chose not to. So therefore, we are holding Hunter Biden in contempt of Congress. And I would also like to say, you had the opportunity when you all were in charge, or y'all were in charge, to do the same with the members on our side of the aisle. You didn't do that. That's not our fault. That's yours. So we're here to talk about Hunter Biden. For everyone watching today, and for my colleagues on the other side of the aisle, I want to be clear again what this hearing is really about. Hunter Biden was subpoenaed to answer Congress, right? That's it. Questions. But he violated federal law by failing to appear before the committee. You can't spin that, for my colleague on the other side of the aisle. You can't spin that. The bottom line is, Hunter did not show up, and he committed a crime. You see, we are a land of laws, and we must follow those laws. And that's what we're here to do today. Instead, he was on the grounds of the U.S. Capitol, where he made a public statement without taking questions from the media, conveniently. So instead of showing up for his legal obligation, he showed up just steps away from a hearing room to spit in the face of this Congress. And unfortunately, that is Hunter Biden's MO. We're merely doing our job. What we're doing here today is showing the country that Hunter will not receive special treatment due to his last name. It's very, very simple. And he will be held to the same standard that every other American citizen would be expected to do. Can you imagine if your average America and you get a subpoena and you go in and tell the judge, hey, let me tell you, here's how it's going to work, judge. I'm not showing up. I'm going to do it my way. I know we have laws, but don't worry about those laws because that would never fly. But that's exactly what Hunter Biden's doing. And if we care about this institution, if we care about democracy, at some point in time, we have to hold the law and people who break the law accountable. Or, like my colleague said, we are going to have anarchy. So simply put, it's not about anything else. We're talking about Hunter Biden and his noncompliance. And you can get up and scream and holler and rant and rave and talk about everything but the fact we subpoenaed Congress, legally Hunter Biden, and he chose not to show up. Read the rules. He has to follow the law. I know that's a very foreign concept, but you have to do it. And for the Biden family, you too have to follow the laws. And with that, I yield back.
Gentlelady, yield. Chair now recognizes Mr. Fallon from Texas for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You know, you have to acknowledge that there's a concentrated effort to deflect and distract. And this is not about January 6th, and unfortunately for the Democrats, it's not about Donald Trump. This is about Biden family corruption, plain and simple. And what really gets me is from just an individual and from an American to being an American is the fact that I disagree vehemently with most of our friends across the aisle when it comes to politics. I will submit that most folks that serve in Congress, whether they're Democrats or Republicans, are not corrupt. They're not on the make. They're not trying to enrich themselves. Hunter Biden is. The Biden family was. And so to sit here and defend a fella that doesn't merit that kind of defense is just interesting. And quite frankly, I find it sad as well. And I think he's a coward to come in here with this stunt again, because, you know, you can define someone that's all about themselves by the way in which they act. And he clearly does that. That's what we're here to discuss. So let's talk about the process, because we've been told that, hey, he was here, he's ready to testify, just let him testify. For the American people, to make it very clear and digestible, when you are deposed in Congress, the majority gets an hour and the minority gets an hour, and it can go on indefinitely. So what usually happens is you can get 100 hours of questions in. You can go drill down. You can get into the efficacy of the procedure, because you can go in depth. And you can hold whoever is the witness to account. If we have just public testimony, what happens here is we all get 5 minutes, times roughly about 60 equals 300, doing the math without a calculator, that's 5 hours. So instead of hundreds of hours, you only get five. And witnesses are very good with their counsel to deflect and distract and answer really slowly, etc. That's why this is about procedure. 100 hours, 200 hours, and then we can come in to public testimony and ask questions about what we have read and make that public. So what I would have loved to, he was here, he left, unfortunately, because I would have loved to at least ask questions while he's in the room for the first time. I've never laid naked eyes on the man until just now. But I would have loved to have asked certain questions like, why did he feel special that he could evade paying taxes on millions of dollars of income? Why doesn't he pay it back? I know a lot of it is already outside of the statute of limitations, so he can't be prosecuted for it, but he can certainly still pay it back. That's a moral obligation that any American has. I'd like to ask him what he did, his company did, to earn $3.5 million from Yelena Batorina, who was married to a corrupt oligarch who used to be the mayor of Moscow. What did he do to have Kenish Rajakev from Kazakhstan wire him $142,300? The very next day, he bought a Porsche. What did he do for Mr. Rajakev? What did he do? Did he get bribed, naked bribe, $5 million by Mykola Zolchevsky? And did he have any experience in the energy sector prior to his father becoming vice president, because Zolchevsky paid him $1 million a year? Interestingly enough, the CFO of Burisma, Vadim Pazarsky, had dinner after he paid Hunter Biden millions of dollars, had dinner with his then-sitting vice president dad at Cafe Milano. Did that happen? Because it seems like it did. Did Kenish Rajakev, who gave him, but essentially bought him the Porsche, he also had dinner with his dad. And yes, coincidentally, Yelena Batorina as well had dinner with his sitting vice president father at the time. Who, I would also like to have asked him, having been an entrepreneur and business person myself, why create 30 shell companies if you have a legitimate business? What did your business do? What services did they provide? What goods did they sell? Who pockets seed money? I have never met anybody in business that pocketed seed money. It's the lifeblood of your venture. Why did you take millions from foreign entities? And who was the big guy, Mr. Hunter Biden? Was it your dad? 10% for the big guy? When you said in that WhatsApp message that I'm sitting right here with my father, was your father really there? Will you give up your geolocations on your phone with your dad so we can determine if you guys were actually in the same room at that time? Why did you email your daughter or text her and tell her about, boy, I wish I didn't have to give 50% of my salary to dad? This all is just questions that under a deposition, when we have hundreds of hours, we could ask this. And I'm only one member of a committee of 60. I'm sure my colleagues would have plenty of questions as well. So this is what it's about. It's about justice. And think about who you're defending here. He's not worthy of your defense. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Gentleman yields.
Mr. Langworthy for 5 minutes.
Well, we've certainly had enough distractions here today. And in the political stunt that we saw here at the beginning of this hearing, Hunter Biden strutting in here like a real tough guy while he refused to sit for a deposition that he'd been lawfully subpoenaed to do. It must be embarrassing to have to defend all of this. And we certainly have Trump derangement syndrome on display in a big way in this chamber today. Over the last year, the Oversight Committee has uncovered a plethora of evidence that is directly pointing at the corruption from Joe Biden and his family. This level of corruption is what you'd expect to see in a third world country, not the United States of America. If the volume of evidence was uncovered on any other influential family in the United States, my colleagues on the other side of the aisle would no doubt initiate thorough investigations. Now, just imagine if Hunter was a Republican. The president's son does not deserve special treatment, period. Holding Hunter Biden in contempt of Congress is the responsible reaction to his blatant disregard for federal law and our duty to investigate potential wrongdoings by the President of the United States. This committee has analyzed thousands of pages of bank records, leading to the discovery of $24 million of wire transfers in payments from foreign companies and foreign nationals directly to this Biden family. Through interviews with Biden family closest associates, the committee discovered that Hunter Biden used his father's name and influence in meetings with foreign nationals over 20 times. Witness testimonies proved that Hunter Biden dined with foreign individuals from countries such as Russia, Ukraine, and Kazakhstan alongside his father, who is the sitting vice president of the United States. And the list of evidence goes on and on. The president himself has been exposed for lying. Both the White House and Hunter have used every tool at their disposal to obstruct this investigation and to block the gathering of evidence. This blatant corruption must be held to account. It's one of the major duties of this very committee. And that's why on September 12, 2023, as a result of the significant evidence against the current president, the Speaker of the House asked the Oversight Committee to conduct an inquiry to determine whether or not sufficient grounds existed for the impeachment of President Biden. Hunter Biden's testimony is a critical component of the impeachment inquiry into whether President Biden or his family personally profited from his office as vice president or his current role as president of the United States. And these facts cannot get in the way. We have got to get on with this investigation and end the distractions that we've heard here today. Let's get this contempt provision put forward, and let's move forward with this impeachment inquiry.
Will the gentleman yield? Will the gentleman?
Time has expired. Chair recognizes Mr. Burleson from Missouri.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What should be obvious to the American people, what I think we need to just say to the American people is to point out that this kind of food fight, this circus that we've experienced is the reason why we want to have a deposition. In a deposition, you don't get people distracting the American public with all these other topics. And during a deposition, they don't get to lie to the American people for 5 minutes at a time. They don't get to distract. They don't get to lie. And they don't get to divert from the facts of what's happening. But what I see happening is what's being telegraphed here is that they're building a case, a political case, really, because that's what this is. It's all politics that they're entering into for why the Department of Justice, or giving Merrick Garland an excuse, which we all knew that he would not prosecute, probably not prosecute these contempt charges, because it would be hypocritical if he did so. Because he prosecuted Steve Bannon, even though Bannon was actually working for the president, and was able to raise the speech and debate clause that was mentioned in the Constitution, Merrick Garland still prosecuted him for that. Here's what's really frustrating to the American people, and they see right through this. We're now going through a second process over really the same crimes that were committed when Joe Biden was vice president. And those crimes include the creation of dozens and dozens of limited liability companies, dozens of bank accounts. When people say, where are the facts? Well, I want to ask, what facts are you looking for? Because to me, bank records are facts. Suspicious activity reports are facts. Copies of checks are facts. When you juxtapose that with the WhatsApp message and what's on the Hunter Biden laptop and the deposition from witnesses like Mr. Archer, when you add to it further depositions, as we're going to hear about soon, the art dealer, when you layer all that together, that's a compelling story. There's a lot of facts. And you know what? I would hate to be on the other side of the aisle and try to defend this situation. And so I think that the only outcome would be to distract, to try to make this a political process. But it still stands as a fact that when the Democrats were in charge, they brought in the president's son. They brought him in multiple times, and they brought him into depositions, and he agreed. And this should be the takeaway message to the American people. When the Trump family was asked, when they came in and they gave depositions, the Biden family, once again, Hunter Biden feels that he's privileged. He's privileged. He doesn't have to pay taxes like everyone else. He's privileged that apparently he can traffic sex workers across the globe and get away with it. He's privileged in that he can get away with with acting as a foreign advocate and be able to get away with it when other people are prosecuted and sent to jail for the very same thing. The American people see that there's two standards of justice. And when we're trying to go about the people's business in a serious manner, we end up allowing a food fight, which is exactly why he did what he did when he went across the street as far away as he could from this building and had his press conference, and then why he today showed up when the hour is way too late. I yield the remainder of my time.
Ms. Brown. Florida for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A couple of things. First, it was said in this hearing, Mr. Chairman, about you specifically, that you repeatedly said you would give Mr. Biden any opportunity he could choose which one to come and speak in front of this committee. He could do it by deposition. He could do it by open hearing. It was up to him. The truth of the matter, though, is, members, is that the chairman's words are not binding. Like, no other member's words of Congress are really not binding. The binding article.
Point of order. Does the chairman agree with that? Point of order. Does the chairman agree?
Are you going to restore my time?
Point of order. Just point of order. Okay. Does the chairman agree that the chairman's words are not binding on the committee?
That's not a point of order. It has nothing to do with the order of this hearing. Thank you. Can I go back to 4 minutes and 34 seconds? That's where I was before I was interrupted by Mr. Raskin.
Yes. Reset the
Thank
clock.
Thank you. Thank you. What is binding is the actual written document, the written language in the subpoena, because a subpoena from this committee is also signed off on by the clerk of the House. That is the binding document that matters here. That is what governs. That's number one. Number two, that was said in this hearing. It was said that our witnesses said that there was no basis for an impeachment. But remember, members on the Democrat side of the aisle, what was said by Mr. Turley at the time was that there was plenty of evidence for the continuation of an impeachment inquiry. And the purpose of that hearing was the relevance basis for an impeachment inquiry. The House has now voted for an impeachment inquiry. And one of the first things that the House did after the vote of an impeachment inquiry was to subpoena Hunter Biden to appear. Hunter Biden has evaded that subpoena. So flagrantly did he evade it that he decided to show up at the Senate side to give a press conference, and Eric Swalwell, a member of the House, helped him get that time on the Senate side to give a press conference. That's a flagrant violation of a congressional subpoena. Secondarily, he has the gall to show up here when we're actually discussing contempt. And he didn't stay. He was sitting right over there. He's not here now. He said he wants to talk. He could have stayed through the whole proceeding. He chose to leave. That's his business. But he was subpoenaed to come here. Back in December, he chose not to of his own volition. He's in violation of that subpoena, a subpoena that was executed with the signature of the clerk of the House of Representatives. That is the document that is binding. That's what we work off of. Mr. Chairman, I actually want to submit for the record an article from The Hill written by Jonathan Turley, and it is titled Eric Swalwell and the Politics of Contempt.
Without objection, so ordered.
Thank you. I'm glad something got admitted to the record. A couple other points. One quick point I want to make, and this is in reference to the minority's report about this $7.8 million. I want the minority to understand one very important distinction between President Biden and President Trump. President Trump has an international real estate portfolio that he has amassed over decades. I'm quite sure if you go back through all of the hotel receipts before he was president of the United States, that you had foreign dignitaries staying at Trump hotels all across the world.
Will the gentleman yield?
I'm not going to yield, Mr. Raskin. I'm making a point. Because they're actually very nice hotels. They look good. People like staying there. President Trump was not running the Trump Organization when he was president of the United States. To my recollection, Eric Trump, the president's son, was actually running the Trump Organization when President Trump was president of the United States. So if he had a portfolio of hotels and people choose, you know, through Expedia, through Kayak, through hotels.com, if they choose to go and stay there, how is that the president being in violation of what the emoluments clause? Is that what you're citing? Stop. Ladies and gentlemen, America, this is ridiculous. The Biden family has no business. They've never had a business except for politics. And the one thing that the Oversight Committee, in conjunction with the Ways and Means Committee and in conjunction with the Judiciary Committee, has always been able to demonstrate is that they shook down foreign nations for millions, Millions. 26 million at the latest count and growing. Millions. And there was never any business entity involved except public corruption and a pay-for-play scheme. The House Oversight Committee would like to get to the bottom of this under the impeachment inquiry of the House. We have questions for Hunter Biden. We issued a subpoena for him to answer said questions. He ignored a congressional subpoena as a private citizen. There are many attorneys on the other side of the aisle. If you had one of your clients in your private practice ignore a congressional subpoena as a private citizen, you would advise them not to, because they would be held in contempt and they would actually be punished by the Department of Justice. So I find that interesting.
Will the gentleman
yield
so I can
respond?
I'm
not going to yield, Mr. Goldman, because I had a question for you earlier. You didn't want to take my question, so I'm not going to take yours. Thank you. So, in closing, I will say, private citizens, yes, they have a responsibility to answer congressional subpoenas. They do. Hunter Biden had it, and he was flagrant. He decided to give a press conference. So we're going to do this business, and he should be held in contempt by the full House of Representatives. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Very good. Chair. Today, the House Oversight Committee voted to hold Hunter Biden in contempt of Congress. This is something that, unfortunately, we had to do. We've conducted this investigation for over a year. We've been very transparent with the American people. We've been very transparent with the media. We've published four substantive bank memorandums that show concerning transactions from our enemies around the world. We've referenced several hundreds of suspicious activity reports that the banks filed, very concerned about suspicious activity by the Biden family. We've heard testimony from IRS whistleblowers about the IRS and Department of Justice investigating various members of the Biden family for criminal wrongdoing. And can we get you all out, or you just be quiet while we do this interview? Everybody pipe it down. So what we saw today, unfortunately, was a stunt by the president's son to come in. This is the second time when he was supposed to be here in this room. The first time was the day we were supposed to have the deposition. He showed up in front of the Senate and had a press conference, said he was there to answer questions, then got in the car with Eric Swalwell and drove off. Today he came here, he sat on the front row, and the day we voted to hold him in contempt, he didn't bother to show up or tell anyone he was coming or try to work with us on a date for a deposition. We heard Moskowitz say that the president's son was here, he was sitting there to answer questions. When Moskowitz's time expired, I recognize Ms. Green. She wanted to ask him questions, and he got up and left. So I don't know what the purpose of the stunt was, but at the end of the day, Hunter Biden doesn't set the rules for Congress. We believe that he's been given special treatment by the Department of Justice, by the FBI, by the IRS, and in each instance, he was the investigators were told to stand down. We want to bring him in. We have hundreds of substantive questions that we want to ask the president's son about specific transactions, about specific bank violations, and about specific conversations, referencing emails, text messages, and other depositions and interviews. We expect him to come. He was held in contempt today. We passed it out of committee in both oversight and judiciary. That will now move to the House floor, I would assume, next week. With that, I'll be happy to answer any questions. Yes, absolutely. I've been very clear on that. I've said from day one, we want the president's son to come to a public hearing if he chooses, but the deposition isn't debatable, that he's not being treated any differently than anyone else. I know in the previous administration, many of my colleagues on the other side of the aisle were quick to send subpoenas to members of President Trump's family, and they came. They honored their subpoenas. They spent hours and hours in depositions. This is an investigation that I think has a lot more substance and a lot more credibility than anything they did in the previous administration. We've heard mention of the previous president's transactions with some of his businesses. We've talked about transactions with the Biden businesses, but the problem is we don't know what those businesses are. We sincerely don't, and I don't think anyone in here does. If you do, I'll yield time to anyone in the press. If you can tell me what service was provided, what good was produced to any of these foreign nationals that sent millions and millions of dollars to the Biden family. So we will be more than happy to have a public hearing after the deposition.
Did you know that Hunter Biden was coming today? And since he was here, why not just question him?
We have rules. The rules say you have to notice deposition 3 days. We have rules. And they know the rules. Jamie, you're asking used to be a stickler for rules until they applied to Democrats. So we're doing everything by the book. This has been very transparent. We anticipate on publishing a report at the end. I would anticipate there will be criminal referrals in that report. We don't want to do anything that's not by the book, that's not by the rules, that can be kicked out on a technicality. We're doing this the right way. As with any investigation, whether it's a congressional investigation or a legal investigation, you get to the point at the end of the investigation where you bring people in and you talk to them. That's what we want to do with Hunter Biden. We want to talk to Hunter Biden. We want to ask him questions along with Jim Biden, as well as Kevin Morris, who is sitting in here today, who by our accounts has loaned Hunter Biden nearly $6 million. And, you know, those can be answered in deposition.
Will you still be able to write your final report if there is litigation about Hunter Biden coming in to testify? And are you at all concerned about that slowing down the pace of your investigation?
Well, I mean, obviously everything they're doing is to obstruct and to slow down and to do everything they can to delay. But, you know, we're going to move forward. We're going to continue to bring people in for depositions. And if they don't come in for depositions, if they don't honor our lawful subpoenas, then we will hold them accountable. That's what just happened in this room. We held them accountable for defying lawful congressional subpoenas.
Do you have assurances from leadership that the contempt votes will go to the full House next week, as you mentioned?
We have assurances it'll go to the House, so I don't know a specific date. I would assume next week.
And have they indicated whether they're going to combine your resolution and the judiciary resolution into one package or vote on them separately?
I would say it would be one package, but I'm not sure. I would assume it would be one package, but I don't. You know, I don't know the exact answer for that.
And what do you say to members that are calling this a wild goose chase and a waste of time?
Well, I mean, bank records don't lie. And we've produced lots of bank records. We've produced four substantive bank memorandums. When they said that no money has been traced to Joe Biden, that's just simply not true. Even if those were loan repayments, which they weren't, but for Annie's sake, we'll say they were, okay? The money they used to pay the money back came from influence peddling. Those accounts, and Goldman tried to make it complicated because that's what they do in money laundering teams. Those accounts were depleted. There was no money in those accounts. It wasn't hard to trace the money. When you have a checking account that for 90 days has a balance of about $4,000 and then it gets a $200,000 wire, and then that same day they write a check for $200,000, that's a pretty easy thing to trace, and that's what we did to trace the money.
Have you had any communication with Hunter's team between December 13th and now?
Have we had? I don't know.
No, and just to go right.
No,
here.
No communication whatsoever.
And you didn't know he was going to show up.
Had no idea. When we suspected something was up, the Secret Service was in here sniffing around before the start of our committee, so we assumed something was going to happen. That's a good question to ask the Democrats. Did they know that Hunter Biden was going to pull this stunt today? And that's what this was a stunt, a PR stunt. The last stunt, I would assume he was there to try to receive some type of pity from the American people. But look, the American people have one question. All this complicated investigation, all these transactions, there's one basic question. What did they do to receive the $24 million from our adversaries around the world? Did they stay at a hotel owned by the Bidens? Did they golf at a golf course owned by the Bidens? Did they produce a good or service that was being provided by the Bidens? What exactly did they do? And are you okay with public corruption? Is it okay if the President of the United States sells access to our enemies around the world to his family? Through his family. Is that okay? I don't think it is. I don't think the American people think it is. And the American people want somebody to get answers. The IRS hasn't been able to get answers. We heard that from Ziegler. They haven't been able to get answers. We know the Department of Justice hasn't been able to get answers. We know the FBI hasn't been able to get answers. Quite frankly, many of you in the media haven't done a whole lot to try to get answers. We're doing that. The House Oversight Committee do that, and we're doing that in a transparent manner, and we will continue to do that.
In your contempt report, you said, short of the president, Hunter's probably your most important witness. Just going down this path of contempt is a long process. Now the House vote has to get recommended to D.C. Attorney General, Department of Justice has to weigh in. Can you finish your impeachment inquiry and recommend impeachment without interviewing him?
We're going to find they impeach. Judiciary impeaches.
Can you finish your investigation without
We certainly hope so. All we need are people to come in for the depositions, and then we'll be finished. We just need people to show up for the depositions, and we'll wrap this up. Nobody wants to wrap this up more than I do.
Last question.
Anybody?
Are you at all concerned that the fact that he has offered to testify publicly and that at one point you said you would be open, to have him come in hurts your court case?
That what now?
Does this hurt your court case, the fact that he's offered to testify publicly?
No, it's a lawful subpoena, and the Department of Justice is... Steve Bannon offered to do the same thing. There's a similar scenario. Steve Bannon, when he got subpoenaed, wanted to come for a hearing in lieu of a deposition, and they said no. Raskin said no.
Not until the Justice Department's going to prosecute
him. Well, is the Justice Department going to treat Hunter Biden the same way? That's the question you need to be asking Merrick Garland. And look, at the end of the day, after the deposition, we want Hunter Biden to come. He can come, answer all the questions from the committee after the deposition. Because look, the hearing, you all know, and let's not be naive here. Everyone knows that the most substantive forum to get a bunch of questions answered is a deposition. There's no question about that. The hearing, we're going to provide that too, if he wants it. If he doesn't, that's fine. That's what I've said all along. If he wants to have a hearing, that's fine, after the deposition. So thank you all. Sorry it's been a long day. We'll be in touch.